Dividend Investors, bonjour, Mike Roux here, founder of Dividend Stocks Rocks and passionate investor. We're finally there. All Canadian banks reported their earnings. I know most of them did it last week, but I had to wait until Scotiabank had decided to put it up on June 1st. So here's my video on Canadian banks. We're going to review the quarter for all the banks in this video instead of doing like a long thing with like different type of banks, because let's be honest, they're all going to tell you the same stories. We are going to dig today to understand how in the world most banks showed 100, 200% earnings jump. This is kind of crazy. Are we going to get any dividend increase so far? And finally, what they're going to do with that extra money. But first, I want to thank you, because over the past 2 weeks, we had a major promotion at Dividend Stocks Rocks. A lot of members came in. Actually, several hundreds decided to join DSR, become passionate investor like me. And this is just amazing. I just want to thank you for your trust. I want to thank you for following us on YouTube. If you're not a member, that's okay. We're still going to be out to provide you with great content. But overall, I was just felt a lot blessed to be able to live that dream. And I want to thank you for it. So now back to banks. Let's start with the beginning of this year. The market, as you can see on this graph, the overall industry thought, you know what, banks are going to do well, the vaccines are coming up, and we're pretty sure that the economy is going to reopen. So now what we see here is on the bottom of the graph, you see the TSX total return. It's up 18% for the 6 month of the year. And then for the first five months, actually, because it's as of June 2nd. Now you have BMO, CIBC, that was leaders of the pack in their recovery since the beginning of the year. And then you have National Bank, TD Bank, Royal Bank, and Scotiabank that is almost following the market. But overall, the market was sending a clear signal. We love Canadian banks, and we think that there's a lot room for them to grow. So what you see on this graph, besides National Bank that just went through the roof over the past 5 years, we have all the other banks that did a lot better than the TSX nonetheless. TSX total return for the past 5 years is 70%. So now we have most of them in the 80s or 90s percent up. And unfortunately, just Scotiabank that is trailing a little bit. My point here, when I want to show you this, is most banks will tell you the same stories. They are evolving. They are operating in the same market as well. So therefore, whenever there's interest rate going up or going down, when there's a recession, we're going to talk about provision for credit losses. When the market goes well, we're going to talk about wealth management and capital markets, but they will tell you pretty much the same story. This is why this time I'm doing one video. If you want to learn more about each individual banks, just go in the link below. I have plenty of videos about Canadian banks. I am a former banker myself. I've worked for National Bank for 13 years. Great time there. Amazing bank, obviously my favorite. You can probably know that by now. But just to show you that if you invest in five or six banks, you're not improving your portfolio. You're not diversifying it. You're actually just doing diversification. So pick your top three, pick your top two at most. Mine are National Bank and Royal Bank. Those are have been my top two for the past more than 10 years, actually. I have them in my portfolio and I don't have the others. So make sure that you don't go crazy on those, and then you can focus on what really matters is sector diversification a lot more than having five or six banks in your portfolio. Now back to the results, which are kind of crazy. Earnings job come from Scotiabank at up 83%, all the way up to CIBC at 282%. How can this be possible? Actually, it's all a matter of playing with provision for capital losses. And I'm not gonna say it's playing in a sense that they're trying to pull out a quick trick, but the thing is, last year, for the same quarter, all the banks besides Scotiabank, and then you're going to understand why they're trailing by that much in terms of earnings performance, they declared massive capital, massive protection for capital losses, for credit losses, sorry. The point here is they look at their loan portfolio and they say, oh, this one, and that one, you know what, considering the pandemic and so on, I don't think my hotel loans or my restaurant loans are going to perform very well. Some energy back then as well. So they put them into provision for credit losses. So they're basically telling their shareholders and their banker, you know what? We might incur losses in our loan portfolios. Here are the details. This has a direct effect on earnings. So if you put for $100,000, $100 million in provision for credit losses, it decreases your earnings by the same $100 million. So the reason why Scotiabank doesn't show EPS higher than 100% jump this time is because their loan provision was smaller than other banks. So you can see that they waited another quarter. So technically, I'm already telling you that in 3 months from now, I'm going to make a video and I would bet $2 that Scotiabank would show the stronger earnings growth. But it's not really earnings, let's be honest. It's just the provision that was there, just thinking, oh, in case we're going to put it there and that's it. But this is not an actual loss and this is not actually money getting out of the bank. What I did some quick calculation here. I looked at the net income before taxes, before provision for credit losses. And then you can see that CIBC and National Bank went up by 13%. BMO did well, up 3%. And then the others, Royal Bank and TD and Scotiabank, they were down 10, 7, 30%. What it tells you that if you take away their loan book, they didn't do that well quarter for the next quarter. And this shows you how it is difficult. But you know, there are a lot of headwinds against banks right now. You have small interest rates, meaning that they're not making that much money on their loans. There's also the recession, so there's less loans coming up. It's harder to grow your loan portfolio and your deposit portfolio because the economy is slowing down. And finally, especially for TD Bank and Scotiabank, because they have exposure to the US for TD and international market for Scotiabank, currency headwinds. Over the past 6 months, we have seen the oil and gas industry surging. And whenever this happens, there's another impact is the Canadian dollar gain in strength. We don't have a petrodollar, but it's pretty close to that. So whenever there's a big fluctuation over there, we're going to follow, the dollar will follow the oil price. So whenever the oil price is going up, and this time, man, it's recovering like there's no tomorrow, well, you're going to have a lot more strength for the Canadian dollar, meaning that your US dollar revenue or your pesos or your coronas revenue are going to be smaller. And this what affected Scotiabank and TD Bank particularly. On the other side of things, when we look at the capital ratio, the tier one, hard to say for a French guy. So for the liquidity ratio, they're all above 12%. Major performance for TD. What it tells you is all banks are incredibly well capitalized right now. One other reason is, yes, they are very conservative, but regulators has put an hold on the dividend. So obviously more money in their pocket, so they have more liquidity. They don't necessarily know what to do with that right now because they rather be prudent than anything else. So they put that on the side, they show strong ratios, and everybody feels good about it. In terms of PE ratio, this year of PE is not really a good thing to look at because we still have earnings that were affected by the provision for credit losses. It's better to look at the forward PE where you get back to normal between 10, 11. That makes a lot more sense. This is pretty much where we sit when we look at banks. Sometimes you'll have an amazing opportunity and you're going to get close to 10 or maybe sometimes a little bit under 10. But roughly, if you have a forward PE ratio between 10 and 12, that's pretty much the average for banks. And this is what makes them so amazing because they're still show some great growth vectors and they're still very generous with their dividend payment. Now, if we move to the next slide, what we're going to see here is actually the difference in the earnings per share, but for the past 3 years. You know, it's unfair to look at what happened last year and what happened this year because of the PCLs that I just explained. So now you want to look at what's the actual trend for those companies. Is it making sense? Are they progressing? So it's even better to look at what happened in 2021 versus 2019. What you see on the graph is they're all making more money. Scotiabank, not that much, but we're missing a quarter on this graph. Unfortunately, I wanted to pull out this video today on Thursday, but Whitrite, I didn't incorporate the last quarter there. So unfortunately, I'm a little bit behind here. My guess is we're going to see something in the plus 15, plus 20%. Bank of Montreal got a lot of problem with their capital market last year. So this explains what happen for their earnings, but they're not in difficulties. But if you look back in terms of before the pandemic, they were also the less generous bank in terms of dividend increases. They were the latest to start increase it after the financial crisis. So most of them did it in 2010, 2011. BMO waited until 2012. And second thing is their growth rate was diminished as well compared to the other banks. So not necessarily my favorite right now. Hopefully they're going to get back on the game. But right now, it's not necessarily the bank that I would bet my $2 to be the first one to increase their dividend. So what about the dividend increase? Is it going to happen now? Chances are it will happen by the end of this year. A lot of investors hope for a special dividend. And you know what? If you look at those payout ratios, I mean, national banks are now at 35% payout ratios. We have like 45, 35 for TD as well, 40 for Bank of Montreal, 44 for Royal Bank. It's pretty low, right? So it tells you, oh, they have ample of liquidity, they make so much money, they could afford a special dividend. But now think about it the other way. Whenever you go to the restaurant, even though you're making a good salary, you had a good year on the stock market, you feel good about yourself, are you going to give a 75% tip on your bill? I don't think so. Not because you have a lot of money in your pocket. You're not necessarily going to spread it across the world just to make people smile. So even if the person that is serving you at the restaurant is making you feel great, you're having a great moment, you're going to give a good tip, but you're not going to go above and beyond. And I think this is what's going to happen with banks. I think banks will go back to their classic 5-6% dividend growth rate per year. They're probably not going to try to catch up because they're going to use that money to do something else. We heard rumors of mergers and acquisition to invest more in technology as well, because don't worry, there's more competitors coming. There's another phenomenon called DeFi, decentralized finance, that is linked to the cryptocurrency. So now there are like new ways to do finance. There's new fintech stocks as well that are coming up with applications and so on that want to compete against banks. I don't think it's the time for banks to sit on their throne and say, we're the king of capitalism, and then we're just going to wait and everything's going to be fine. I'd rather like having those banks keeping that money in their pocket and do something with it. You know, finance 101, if the business has money in their bank account and they have plans and projects that will create value for shareholders, such as merger and acquisition, investing in R&Ds, developing new technologies or new services, investing in marketing, whatever will boost sales and earnings, they're better off doing this than sending the money back to shareholders in the form of dividend. So the dividend is safe. It's going to keep increasing for sure, but I expect 5-6% as soon as regulation permits it. But for the rest, I expect and I hope that a bank like National Bank will continue on its streak and buy new branches or another bank elsewhere. They did it very well with Credigy in the US, amazing with ABA Bank in Cambodia. So hopefully they're going to move on to something more interesting. So in summary, just a couple of highlights for each bank. So let's start with National Bank. The bank did amazing pretty much everywhere, and it's the one with CIBC that shows the strongest earnings growth if we don't count the PCL shuffle. So again, great bank to invest in. They're doing well and they're well on their things. For Royal Bank, the game changer was capital market. They have a big chunk of their money, of their business generating money from capital markets. The market is doing well. They will benefit from it. That was the same story from BMO. Obviously, last year, actually, BMO had to report a loss on their capital markets on the trades. Obviously, when the market goes up and down like this, sometimes you get stinged. So this time, BMO has done very well with their capital market as compared to the last year. And the last one with capital market with CIBC. CIBC did very well on that part. Their loan book is healthy, so they had a very great quarter. As I mentioned earlier, TD Bank did very well, but currency fluctuations, since they have one third of their business in the US, the difference between the US dollar and the Canadian dollar is shrinking like there's no tomorrow right now. So obviously that hurt their portfolio. And we've seen a similar situation with Scotiabank. Scotiabank is a little bit more concerned once again because their narrative of being more international may take a while before it plays well. I'm not saying it's a bad strategy, but I'm thinking it may take a few more quarters, maybe a year, to start performing even better, because obviously vaccines and the economy are going to reopen a lot faster in developed economies in North America versus countries like Chile, where they have a little bit more problem with the COVID-19. So overall, I hope that you have liked this format of a wrap-up. Give me a thumbs up. It helps me a lot to log into your algorithm, and I hope that every time someone will key in Canadian Banks Report on YouTube, I pull up on the first page. I hope that you have enjoyed this video. Please follow me. It's always a pleasure to see that counter going up. And until this next video, stay invested.